water tank purified with cow pee after untouchable woman drank from it. Before we get into the news, I just want to say we only use the word untouchable so that people outside the Indian subcontinent know what we're talking about. Most people don't know what the term Dalit means. And now that I've clarified this, that's the term I'll be using going forward. On November 18th, upper caste Hindus in Karnataka, India, purified a water tank with cow urine after a Dalit, the caste previously known as Untouchables, woman drank water from it. The woman, identified as Shivamma, who was passing through the village on her way to a wedding. Upon seeing her drinking water, a village leader approached her, demanding to know her caste. He told her that people from scheduled castes must not drink from the tank. Scheduled castes is like various forms of lower castes that are in this system within the Indian government. They're just called scheduled or sometimes backward castes. A video of the purification act was uploaded to social media the day after and quickly went viral, spurring a police investigation. V. Somanna, a legislative assembly member, said he would not tolerate such discrimination. On the 20th, officials from the social welfare department spoke to the villagers, telling them that the water tank was public property and was available to all. To demonstrate this point, officials gathered 20 Dalit youth and had them drink water from all public water sources in the area. So, what I thought was very interesting about this, well, one, something that will never make sense to me is the idea of purifying. Let's just walk through what happened originally first. Okay. So there was a woman coming through the village, and she wasn't in from the area, and she drank from a water tank. And because this Dalit woman drank from the water tank, the entire tank had to be emptied and then cleansed with cow urine. Now, first of all, none of this is supposed to make sense, right? One, this is religious, spiritual nonsense and bigotry. Okay, so it's not going to make sense. It's inherently irrational. But if we were going to think about this logically, why would you have to empty the entire water tank when she drank from it? Like, the water came out of the tank into her drinking vessel and she drank it. She didn't touch or come into contact with the rest of the water. Okay. You know, but this is just me overthinking things, right? Two, I know people are supposed to be, you know, sensitive. But the idea of purifying something with the piss of an animal will never make sense to me. I'm sorry. And so that's kind of the backstory behind this. But what actually was kind of more positive, I guess, was the reaction that this garnered. Like, this received widespread condemnation. There were arrests made of people who were involved with this purification ritual. The people in various government bodies took this very seriously and basically intervened very directly to be like, hey, we don't tolerate this. It's not okay to have this like form of bigotry. We're really trying to make progress. And really took proactive action, which was not necessarily what I was expecting. Even going so far as to bring out a bunch of young Dalit kids and be like, oh yeah, we're gonna have them publicly drink from all of the water in these different areas of the village to show that this is something that not only we accept, but we're actively promoting. So I don't know. I thought that aspect of it was very interesting as well. That's why I thought it was like, okay, you know, to kind of clap for this kind of thing because of how seriously it was taken and the intervention that they did. Yeah. No one is saying, why are you using logic, Susie? Honestly, I don't know. Susie overthinking. Yes, this is what I would do. Overthinking is my middle name. Someone saying, Susie, CEO Susie, you don't understand our ways. Stop bringing your Abrahamic mindset into this. And using an Armin yelling emoji. I'm sorry. I can't.
I don't. So just to be clear, human touch of this, like, you just drank from here and it made the entirety of that water inside
spiritually unclean for consumption.
Spiritually unclean. So that's why they had to empty out the whole thing, because a lower caste or outcast woman just drank from just this, and the whole thing had to be emptied out and cleansed with cow urine. So a human's touch, because she's lower caste, it has this much power to make something dirty and unclean. Human touch. But a cow's piss, on the other hand, has the ability to cleanse it. So imagine this. They're putting a certain humans of certain outcast humans, their touch is so unclean, and a cow's piss is so clean that it could undo the dirtiness from this human's touch. You can see how much higher a cow is in the Hindu religion, their status, than somebody who's a Dalit, which is an outcast human. You know, you can see the hierarchy of a cow relative to a human being.
It's really mind-boggling. I can't wrap my head around it. People try to gaslight me and talk about, like, it just because I'm like white, I'm from America, like it's my Western mindset, blah blah blah. I don't think there's any way that this can ever, like, you can put this in any sort of cultural context and make this actually justifiable.
Yeah,
it's ridiculous. Like,
this is, if you ever try to tell Susanna that she doesn't understand this because she's white, then you're the reason why the world is so fucked up, that you justify stuff like this. Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry that I see a human as a human and don't find this so viscerally disgusting that they need to be cleaned. Their touch in your presence needs to be cleaned off with cow urine. Like, that's so dehumanizing. I don't care what culture you're from. It's wild. And I think one thing that Asian American is saying, I'm a Chinese ex-pagan. This has nothing to do with Abrahamism. Yeah, he's like, don't put this on my name.
Yeah.
I think this is very significant to people because Dalits have been fighting for water rights for like centuries, right? But the movement of Dr. Ambedkar for water rights specifically happened almost exactly 100 years ago. And so to a lot of people, seeing stories like this of, you know, having one of the founders of the nation as a child being denied access to water because he is so quote unquote dirty, unclean, impure, untouchable, and to have it still continuing to this day is a very stark reminder to people. And it just makes me think of all the times when we talk about these issues, about how this is a real thing that people face, that people get killed over still to this day. People try to come tell us that casteism and untouchability as a practice doesn't exist.
Yeah.
It drives me crazy.
It's insane. I do want to acknowledge, just so that we're not just all negative and all, I do want to acknowledge that the government sees this as a problem, okay, and is addressing it. So let's not exaggerate over how everything there is bad. Like, the fact that this is seen as a problem, this is something that is, like, some people exaggerate from both sides. They think, like, they say there's no casteism in India. There's a major amount of casteism still in India, okay? This is a major belief, okay? So don't downplay how big of a problem this is. But also don't exaggerate, okay? This is a major belief in India, but it shocks Indians, right? So Indians are shocked by this news, are disgusted by the news.
Exactly.
So
yeah.
This is not a contradiction. It's common in India, but it's also disgusts Indians. And there are many Indians who are motivated in fixing this, in getting rid of this, including the government. Okay. So see, I'm not trying to spin everything like people, some people think we're trying to just be anti-Indian and spin everything negatively. The fact that this is not encouraged and heavily fought against is really hope, you know, gives me hope.
And it yeah, I really liked how they had the Dalit kids come out and publicly drink from every water fountain or every water source. Like, I think that's a really proactive way of tackling things that I think is very powerful. And Cordon Bleu is saying the day after tomorrow, the 6th of December, is Dr. Ambedkar's death anniversary. Please celebrate it. It's a momentous day in Mumbai. Yes, it's called, what's it? Ambedkar Janyati? Yes. Wow. Oh my God. I would love to
be in
one of those celebrations with all the garlands coming out. It's so cool. And one of my favorite things about the Jai Bhim movement is the color blue that they use. They use this very like virulent blue. It's very beautiful. I love that color.
How do you know these things, Susie? It's very impressive. I don't know how you know all of these stuff.
I'm a little bit of an Ambedkar fangirl.
Wait, I need to. Okay. Look, Harris is actually. Yeah, remind me to tell the person who designed this cover that they did a good job. Look at Harris.
I do like the cow. The cow is pretty cute. He's like,
Harris. Harris, look at the cheeky photo of the cow. That cow is like, what the F? Yeah, Susie, remind me to tell the person to our editor that she did a good job designing our cover. That's pretty good.
Wait. Okay, people are correcting me. Then Janyati is his birthday. Excuse me.
I don't know any of this stuff. Get my best-selling book, Why There Is No God, for free. Click on the link for it in the description.